Welcome back to BNC Sports Weekly. You know, most years, April 15th has always been ingrained in our minds to be tax day. But that date means something extra for sports fans, especially African Americans. It was on that day in 1947 when Jackie Robinson broke the color barrier in Major League Baseball. April 15, 1947, Ebbets Field in Brooklyn, New York. Robinson suited up in his number 42 jersey, went 0-for-3, but scored a run in the Dodgers' 5-3 win over the Boston Braves. On Jackie Robinson Day, I spoke with the announcer who made the following call in the 2012 season.
Seattle Mariners, Felix Hernandez, the 2-2.
He got him! 34 years, 119 games. It's finally happened. A perfect game by a Seattle Mariner. It was done by the King, Felix Hernandez.
Many of you have heard that voice over the years from his time calling college basketball games and NFL games, in addition to his role for more than a decade now of being the television play-by-play voice of the Seattle Mariners. Dave Sims joins BNC. Dave, it's a pleasure to have you with us. Thanks for your time. You're in New York City. And first of all, how are you and your family doing in the place that has been hit hardest in America?
Boy, I'll say, Anthony, good to see you. Thanks so much for the time. I appreciate it. We're doing well. We've been inside following orders. We've got our masks, our rubber gloves. The delivery people have been unbelievable. And they're keeping that supply train chain going. So, and yeah, we're getting our exercise in, my wife and my son. So, and my other son's over in Jersey, so knock wood, thank God, we're doing all right, thanks.
Excellent. Well, the Mariners would have had today off, traveling to Oakland to begin an 11-game road trip. How strange has it been to not be in your usual mode, being in the booth, calling baseball games in the early spring?
Rhythm and routine are totally off. Thank goodness for watches and phones. What day is it? What time is it? when I do look at the schedule, it's... you know, I think about where I would have been. I was going to see a bunch of friends in D.C. because we would have just completed a couple of games against the Nationals, the world, spending World Series champions. It's been strange, and I've filled up my Baseball Jones with documentaries and Ken Burns' baseball and MLB Network stuff that they've been running. And now, of course, Jackie Robinson Day, a lot of, you know, I'm looking back and trying to discover maybe some old film or video I've never seen on Jackie Robinson, and I think I've seen a lot of it.
Well, I'll touch on the present day's baseball and more on the Mariners in just a moment. But as you mentioned, this is Jackie Robinson Day. 73 years ago today, he broke the color barrier in the majors by making his debut with the Brooklyn Dodgers, not too far away from where you are now. Give our viewers a sense of what Jack Roosevelt Robinson meant to you.
Well, I would say after my dad is my greatest hero, because once I heard about who he was and what he did and how he did it, what he went through, it's like all of a sudden, my pot runneth over, the kettle runneth over in esteem and admiration. And he's one of the most consequential Americans, not just sports figures, consequential Americans of the 20th century, to the point where Dr. King saluted him, you know, way back in the mid-50s, saying that, you know, if Jackie Robinson did not accomplish what he set out, Dr. King would not have been able to be successful in his lane. So, you know, and the other thing I always talk about Jackie Robinson, I mean, baseball is a difficult game. It's a game built based on failure. I mean, 70% of it, if you fail 70% of the time, you're a superstar. And here's a guy that went out and had just, can you imagine going to work and people cussing at you, screaming at you, spitting at you, calling you every name? Well, he went out and excelled. He won Rookie of the Year his first year in 1947, came back with an MVP a couple of years later. I mean, what more can you say about the guy?
Yeah, people doing all that and not retaliating. I mean, just unconscionable. Now, I know you never met Mr. Robinson personally, but you have met his widow. Give us a sense of what that was like.
Well, she has the same strength of character that he had, and Jackie Robinson would be nothing without her. I mean, thank God for Rachel Robinson. And I met her here in New York, I want to say 1985, and I was over around 49th, 50th and Broadway, and I was walking to work, and I see that, you know, I'm looking around and thinking, I said, wait a minute, I know that woman over there. And I thought, well, it's not family. And then I went, duh, it's Rachel Robinson. Ran across through the red light, avoiding traffic, playing Frogger, getting through what was like a Seinfeld episode. And went over and told her, I said, Mrs. Robinson, I said, my name's Dave Sims. I'm a sportscaster, been at it for a while. I would not be here doing this without you and your husband and what you all went through. You know, you carried the cross for us, and you opened the doors for us. And here I am, lucky enough to have this career that I wanted to get into as a sports in sports media as a writer, talk show host, broadcaster, play-by-play. And she was super gracious, wonderful, regal lady, and I subsequently met her at a Jackie Robinson Foundation dinner. You can't say enough about Mrs. Rachel Robinson.
Now, it's interesting you mentioned that. It's not a stretch at all to say if there were no Jackie Robinson, you wouldn't be what you're doing. I wouldn't be what I'm doing. How often do you consider that when you call games?
Every day I wear this 42 cap. Now, this 42 cap was given out on African-American Heritage Day back in Seattle a few years ago. And if I'm wearing black and blue or something that matches this blue and gold, I sport this cap a lot along with my other. I'm a big hat and cap guy. And Todd Frazier came to me one time when he was with the White Sox. He said, "Hey, man, Tim Anderson saw that cap. He wants to get one, but he didn't know you." And he was a little tentative. He didn't, a little bashful coming up. I know Todd a little bit, so I hooked him up with the cap. Jeff Bannister, who was managing Texas, one time he wanted to take it off my head. I love that cap. And everywhere I go, love your cap, love your cap. And a lot of people around the Seattle offices, down the Mariner offices, wear these caps.
That's interesting. You are the only black television play-by-play guy in all of Major League Baseball. Is that a shock to you? Is it discouraging? Why isn't the broadcast booth more inclusive when it comes to African-American announcers?
You know, the non-former player division, too.
Right.
Bill White was an inspiration back in the day when he transitioned from player to broadcaster. It's not discouraging. I got to keep, for me, and I have guys like yourself and a lot of younger guys, and I hear from younger kids, white and black, but especially when I hear from the young black broadcasters, say, "Hey, man, you're the only guy I've ever seen doing this." And it's like the old Joe DiMaggio line, why do you try so hard and why do you try to be as close to perfect as you can every day? And Joe DiMaggio said, "Because somebody's seeing me for the first time." And it's something I carry with me all the time, and I love what I do. And I've been very fortunate, to do, football, baseball, basketball, college basketball, NFL, college football, a little bit of boxing. It's been a great ride. I thank God for it all the time, let me tell you. But I think a lot of it, you don't see a lot of folks like us doing this. Ergo, you don't have a lot of people aspiring to it if we're not out there. So the 30, let's say, just for our discussion's sake, the 100 or so of us broadcasters out there on a national or local basis who are black, we carry a big responsibility.
Absolutely. Well, it's also about the opportunity, as you know.
That's the biggest part, yeah.
Yeah. Now, as far as the numbers, only 7.7% of the 30 major league rosters had black ballplayers on them on opening day a year ago. Correct me if I'm wrong, but the team you call games for, the Seattle Mariners, now have more African-American players than any team in the majors. Is it refreshing, rejuvenating for you to see players like D. Gordon, Malik Smith, Carl Edwards Jr. put on the uniform every day? What does it do for you?
It's exciting. I walk in. I like all our guys. We've had good teams. But for me, given, the time that I was born in, the time I've lived through, seeing and knowing the history of the game, the history of the country, it is really gratifying. I mean, Italians have Columbus Day, you got St. Patrick's Day for the Irish, we got Jackie Robinson Day. And it's great. I can walk into our clubhouse. Last year we finished with 10 African Americans. We have 10 on our 40-man roster right now. And it's not like we speak a different language, but there's some cultural, there's a lot of simpatico there. And to see somebody that looks like me in there, I ain't gonna lie to you, it's great. And when I tell all the guys, my football friends, that we have that many African Americans on our team, they're like, "Wow, really? Good for you." It's a kinship, and it means a lot. And I think I have a good relationship with the white players too. And it's great to have that many, to have that number of black players as well.
Dave Sims, thank you for your time. Thanks for the path that you've paved for so many of us, myself included. We wish you and yours good health as we hopefully get to the end of this pandemic and get back to baseball very soon. Dave, thanks for joining us here on BNC.
Anthony, thank you very much. Appreciate the time, and God bless and stay safe.